Welcome back. Our decision night in America has carried over into Wednesday morning here in the East Coast. And let's walk you through where we are. Alaska right now, we can say that is too early to call. We're looking at a slew of states that are too close, including New Hampshire right now, with 82 votes currently separating the two of them. Pennsylvania, right now it is too close to call, but Trump has moved out slightly in front. To Michigan right now, too close to call, a 58,000 vote difference. Minnesota, too close to call. You see the difference there. In Maine, 17,000 vote difference, too close to call. And the same story for Wisconsin and also Arizona. And these are the states that that keep us all in suspense right now as we bring the camera down on the rink. Watch the states pop up in red and blue and look at that race to 270, Trump at 244, Clinton at 215, with what everyone agrees is an extraordinarily narrow path, essentially needs to run the table to get there.
She does, and right now she's behind in Pennsylvania, and I've run out of vote to see how she catches them in Pennsylvania. Wisconsin, unless there's absentee vote we don't know about, I've run out of vote there. That's game, set, and match. Yeah. We talked about Michigan earlier. I think there's enough vote for her to win Michigan, but it may not matter. Pennsylvania and Wisconsin puts him over the top. There's no worrying about 269s. There's no worrying about Omaha. There's no worrying about Bangor. There's no even worrying about Arizona or Alaska at this point.
Eugene Robinson is back with us. You noted you were here. I don't know. We've been here for all night. You've been a couple hours ago.
I leave for a couple of hours, and the world changes. So what?
That was back on Tuesday. We're on Wednesday.
Yeah. I mean, this is. Look, collectively, we here on this desk, we have covered and participated in a whole lot of political stories. I thought in 2008, with the election of President Obama, I said, well, that's it. You know, I'll never cover a political story as big as that. I was wrong. I mean, this is a nuclear bomb of a political story. It's going to be interesting. It seems to me like, Chuck is the numbers expert, of course, it seems to me likely that Hillary Clinton's going to win the popular vote, because there's a whole lot of votes to come out of California yet. So I think she may well end up with by winning the popular vote, but losing the electoral vote, perhaps more substantially. If she does lose Wisconsin, if she does lose Pennsylvania, and Michigan is still in the balance.
But think about it, right where we are right now. I mean, he is on the cusp of winning the election based on a system that up until yesterday he was saying is rigged.
Yeah.
Right. Think about that for a moment.
I don't think it's rigged anymore.
Democracy. I mean, right? I mean, I think that's a good thing that if democracy is working, votes are getting counted, and the one who gets the most votes wins.
There's going to be a lot of Democrats who are going to complain about the WikiLeaks and are going to complain about Comey. And they had some impact, there's no doubt. But on the other hand, Trump's basic message never changed.
You got to realize the Democratic Party has the least amount of power that you can imagine in this democracy. The Republicans have like 30 state legislators, governors. Mm-hmm. We're going to lose the federal courts, the Senate, mm-hmm. the House, the presidency. I mean, it is a utter disaster if you're a Democrat in terms of having any political power in the country right now.
True, but also the big question that comes out of this is, what does it mean to be in the Republican Party?
Well, but the Republican Party is now led by someone who's not even a Republican.
Well, that's my point. Right. It's like, so, okay, Democrats are out of power, Republicans are in, but what define Republican?
Yet the Republican Party, even though it's led by someone who's not a Republican, is absolutely right, has all this power, and if Trump does win, indeed, is going to have to govern, right? But if Trump is elected, he will have been elected by a segment of the population. I mean, Latino voters came out, African-American voters came out, they came out in robust numbers, but they voted for the other candidate. And it was not a rainbow coalition that will have elected Donald Trump. And it's not just a Rust Belt phenomenon, but it seems to be, the more diverse, cosmopolitan, plugged-in urban areas of the country versus the smaller towns, the rural areas that are not connected to the global economy, that have not felt they have done particularly well from globalization and from technological change.
Eugene, can I ask you this, though?
Mm-hmm. Can we sort of comprehend this fact? We're going to go from the first African-American president,
mm-hmm.
and he's going to be replaced by somebody who mm-hmm. questioned that president's legitimacy
exactly.
for more than half this man's term.
Exactly.
Well, not only
what
that.
What does that say? What is the message that rural America is sending about that?
Well, the message is, you know, I think a lot of the message is embedded in the phrase, take our country back.
Yeah.
You know, and I've always kind of wondered, take it back from whom? And maybe that's the answer.
And to where?
To where, yeah, right.
Well, not only that, I mean, they voted for him because he touched a nerve, and he also came out of the celebrity culture. You know, we've been living at a time when you're known for being known in many ways. He was better known when he entered this race than anybody else. But the fact is that rural America and people who are feeling that the country is going in the wrong direction have selected a man to lead the country who engaged in outright vulgarities, and misogyny, the stuff that he's had to say about people in this country mm-hmm. and how they didn't, the handicap, for example, how he mocked them at the panel. When he was in New Hampshire, a socially conservative state with low unemployment, and went on the stage and uttered the worst vulgarity that you can possibly say in public, and took great pride, and they cheered him on. 25,000 people. That's who he is. And, you know, they tried to change him halfway through the campaign. He wouldn't change because he said, look, I know what I'm doing. I'm putting on a show here. So does he continue that way as the president of the United States? And does that affect how he stands in this country as well? Once they get beyond the rush of having elected a guy who's going to take on the establishment, then when they realize this is who he is at his core.
Yeah.
And everybody who's been around him knows that's who he is.
Now, there's a clumsy 30,000 feet theory of presidential elections. And see if you agree with me on this, Chuck. If you just look at temperament, and you look, for example, President Bush, the first one, is followed by someone totally different than him, right. Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton, with all his attendant scandals, is followed by someone totally different than him, Mr. Clean. So he was, as advertised, George W. Bush. George W. Bush, considered something of a hothead, you know, cowboy type, then replaced by the cool, intellectual,
cerebral.
This is the Rahm Emanuel
theory of presidential politics.
Okay, now if you go with this theory, it has always pointed to Trump, because if you looked up or tried to create in a lab someone completely the polar opposite of Barack Obama in every way, you would come up with a picture of Donald Trump.
Pretty much.
By the way, who are the people, I'm curious, and I can't wait for our exit poll guys to figure this out, the people that approve of the job Barack Obama's doing
mm-hmm.
and voted Trump?
It had to be because his job approval was 55%.
It has been the whole time. There are clearly, look, I've been saying it in the state of Iowa, for sure, and we also know there are a whole bunch of Obama-Trump voters. Obama 12, and they went mm-hmm. Trump. Now, part of it was Obama turned Mitt Romney into the boss that wanted mm-hmm. to fire you and send your job overseas. So Romney was sort of an old Republican argument, you know, the businessman argument, and Barack Obama exploited that.
Yeah.
But add to the things that Tom said, and add to the fact that he didn't know and didn't care to know and kind of relished the fact that he didn't know anything about anything. That he knew more about ISIS and the generals, that he got his information from the TV shows on foreign policy. I mean, all of the things that he said.
Let's bring Mark Halpern in the conversation. He's over there with Hallie Jackson. Hallie?
Hey there, Lester. Yeah, we're actually over in the area where we're getting all of our video and images in from all around the country in battleground states, including at campaign headquarters. My colleague Peter Alexander is reporting a sense of real euphoria inside Trump Tower right now. Mark, you just came over here from, I think, Peninsula, right?
Right.
You were spending some time with Clinton folks.
Yeah.
I mean,
Manhattan is you know, big giant country, and Manhattan is the center of the universe tonight for a change. Hillary Clinton chose to spend her pre-election event time at the Peninsula Hotel. It's four blocks up the road from here, about three blocks from Trump Tower. So she and Donald Trump are basically now three blocks apart. I'm told she's in the hotel with President Clinton, Chelsea Clinton, John Podesta, Robbie Mook, Jennifer Palmieri, mm-hmm. Huma Abedin.
These are her closest advisors, her closest aides. They've been with her from the beginning.
And you can only imagine, I mean, you think about 8 years ago when they lost the Iowa caucuses, there was a similar meeting. A time in a hotel in Des Moines where they were grappling with how to deal with loss. So this is a much more complicated, bigger situation. the Javits Center, where I was earlier, where her event is supposed to be, earlier in the evening, the mood couldn't have been more jubilant. It's the biggest election night event I've ever seen. It's like a theme park over there. And as the results started to come in, you saw the mood deflate. People have laughed, some in tears. There's a game of chicken now of what's going to happen. Is anyone going to speak tonight? We've seen in some of these past 2000 being the most prime example. What do you do if it's the end of the night? It's right. Well,
what
after midnight,
right.
And no one has spoken. I can play with the Electoral College map and get her to a majority still at over 270. This is not done, even if no state that's been projected flips. But the mood over at the peninsula, I didn't talk to any of them, I should be clear, but it's grim over there. I saw more junior aides coming and going. It's a tough situation for the Clintons. They've got to figure out what to do. I don't think Trump wants to speak first, but I think he might, based on what I've been picking up.
You and I were on the air together this morning at around 8:30, talking with Michigan Governor, former Jennifer Granholm, who was euphoric, frankly, almost giddy. Do you think that Clinton and her team and her confidants got too overconfident?
I saw Governor Granholm over at the Javits Center, and I reminded her of how giddy she was this morning, and she did another little jig. I think that tape from Morning Joe is going to be iconic if Hillary Clinton loses this race, because she was the epitome of, I won't say overconfidence, but extreme confidence that they were going to win. This is unlike any race we've ever had. Hillary Clinton, if she has to give a concession speech, it's impossible for me to imagine how you write that speech, because her view of Donald Trump as president was apocalyptic. It wasn't just he's bad on policy.
Lester, we'll toss it back to you. Thanks, Mark.
All right, Hallie, thanks very much. We will take a break a little after 1 a.m. Eastern time. We continue to watch those states too close to call. Both candidates still short of the 270 needed to become the next president of the United States. We continue Decision Night in America on NBC. Night in America, Rockefeller Center, towering above Democracy Plaza, where we continue to watch the race to 270. I want to bring in Doris Kearns Goodwin, presidential historian, to get some flavor and perspective on the night. Doris, it was widely said that, at least on paper, Hillary Clinton was the most qualified candidate for president. Donald Trump may be the least qualified candidate. Is there a historical comparison with someone potentially coming into the White House with so little experience, no experience in government or military?
Well, we very rarely had somebody who didn't have either the political experience or the military experience. There was Wendell Willkie, who challenged FDR in 1940, who was a businessman and a very good guy, actually, but he didn't actually win the presidency. But I think what that's missing is that in the old days, the parties were the ones that would choose their candidates, so they would naturally choose somebody who was one of their own, a governor, a mayor, or a congressman. But the parties have lost their powers now to the primaries. And what we've seen in this race, I think, is the power of this very thing we're on right now, of television. It established a direct link between Donald Trump and the people that a party couldn't establish. Even the Republican Party wasn't for him at a certain period of time. And the power of that celebrity is really going to have to be understood. The debates were powerful because he was on them. Didn't matter that he said things that people disagreed with. He just kept winning. I remember we'd be on Meet the Press on Sundays with Chuck, and we'd say, he's finished, it's over. And then that Tuesday, he would win a primary, which shows that something, the normal institutions that would not produce a man like Trump, that would produce one of their own, have lost their own authority in our country.
But is he not somewhat of a mystery? Now, we know what he has stood for on many things, but he has sometimes changed positions in the middle of one answer on the use of nuclear weapons, among many, many others. So would he enter office a bit of an enigma?
And maybe that's what people were able to do with him, to project that we don't really know what he believes, so that we can imagine that he'll be what we want him to be, even if he's changing his opinions on both sides, rather than choosing somebody who's a known quantity and who you may disagree with. So you may be right. We may not know who we're getting. We know a lot of things about the course and dialogue that was part of this race that I think makes lots of people unhappy and makes us wonder where democracy has gone. But then we got to always remember Churchill. He said, democracy is the worst form of government except all the others that have been tried. So we got to believe somehow that people have chosen him. Then we got to just hope that his leadership is up to that choice that they have made.
And again, looking from a historical perspective, talk about who you put around you, the strength of a team, how much that makes the mark of a president.
It's huge. I mean, it's not even only a question of putting people around you who are your rivals, as Lincoln was able to do. It's much more important to have people around you who have strengths that bolster your weaknesses. But that means having the self-reflection to know what your own weaknesses are. It means knowing that you want people around you who can argue with you, who can question your assumptions, who will challenge you. And that's what we needed to know about Donald Trump. We didn't need to only know whether he was a great businessman. I wish we'd had more reporting on what kind of a team did he have over these years. Were there people who could challenge him? Did he have people around him who were willing to really go after him when he was wrong? Was he able to acknowledge when he made mistakes? These are the things we needed to know about a leader. And unfortunately, the way our race turned out, we were spending so much time on what was said, on who was ahead and what the debates were and who had the zinger, that the kind of qualities that we really need to know about him, we're going to find out in reality rather than through the race itself.
All right. Doris Kearns Goodwin, always good to have you on. Thank you so much for your perspective tonight. And I want to broaden out that notion, let you guys weigh into this idea that Donald Trump, if elected president, would not have any previous political or military experience. And do we know how he would govern? Do we have any clues, Savannah, as to, we know what he has stood for?
To some extent, but if you look at the certain positions he's taken over the course of the campaign, there are very few that he hasn't actually reversed himself on. So I think it's a real question. And I think it'll be interesting to see how the weight of the office, if he ultimately prevails, we're not there yet, but it seems like we're inching closer and closer to that call, whether the weight of that changes him in a way. How could it not? I mean, this is a huge responsibility to go in and say, take the oath of office and stand the steps of the Capitol. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, people... I don't know.
Look,
I mean, we haven't
seen
it.
Look how he turned his back on the political establishment and the political process that got him to where he is. Yeah. He has been a man who celebrates himself 24/7 as a promoter here in New York when he had his real estate empire going, selling the tea all over the world and wherever he could. He loves being in the limelight. He loves making decisions. Everybody's been around him at any length, says the attention span is about that long.
I want to believe the best about someone who's going to now represent millions of Americans.
That's
and
right.
People
we
who have
remember.
Put their faith in
but,
him.
But,
becomes our
but he got there by yeah. being somebody contrary to everybody that you had
I
there before.
I hear you.
So,
I totally
you know,
get
and
it.
You've got, I must say, he got there on his terms. I mean, when he started out, no one gave him any kind of a chance. He stayed true to who he thought he should be and what the country wanted. And it appears tonight that it could very well work for him. I don't think he's going to abandon that just because he's walking through the gate at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
He's made some huge promises to people, and people believed him, and they put their votes behind him,
well, look,
and they're counting on him.
But this is an important thing. He comes in with notion. The weirdest thing is, I think, James, you're right, I think he actually doesn't win the popular vote once California rolls in, and
but
that's
a big
fine.
Electoral vote.
But guess what? He is going to feel like he got a mandate. We are going to treat him like he got a mandate for one reason, because he blew all of our predictions and models and you name it out of the water. He is going to feel unshackled.
Understand, he won an election.
That's right.
That is the most validating thing that can happen. We live in a democracy.
Right.
So
exactly.
He can go and he's going to have congressional majorities in both houses, and a lot of people are going to owe their election to him.
Right, exactly.
You got to understand what is going to happen here. There are real, real consequences.
No, I mean, I think he's going to want to be the boss, number one. And if even if you take the sort of optimistic view and say part of the campaign was a performance for his audience, still, what's his North Star? I mean, and is it suspicion of immigration? Is it
Donald Trump?
But they elected him to blow up the system. I mean, that's why how he got there. And as James says, you know, he got elected under the process of a democracy. People chose him to be their leader because they're so upset with where it's going right now.
I got to be the traffic cop here and get us to a break. We will continue with our Decision Night in America coverage on NBC after this. Welcome back to our continuing coverage of this historic election. We want to take you right down to the Donald Trump headquarters here in Midtown Manhattan. Peter Alexander is with a crowd that is growing restless and with expectations of things going their way.
Yeah, Lester, good evening to you. I just spoke to a source who is with Donald Trump inside Trump Tower right now, who describes the scene there as euphoric, filled with hugs and high fives right now. There's also some new information that NBC News can now report. This from my colleague, NBC's Kelly O'Donnell, who spoke to a top aide to Speaker Paul Ryan. And we have now heard that the speaker earlier tonight reached out by phone, speaking to Donald Trump in what was described as a good conversation, congratulating Donald Trump, and also speaking to his good friend, the potential vice president, Mike Pence, as well. What's striking about this right now, as I speak to folks inside the campaign headquarters, is how strongly they've felt over the course of the night that they would do well, but how this result is even striking and surprising some of them. They thought they would do well in Florida. They thought they'd have a shot at Pennsylvania, but they thought Wisconsin would be too tough. They have a chance to win all three of them.
All right, Peter Alexander, and I think that's an interesting note. I don't know if you hear what Peter said, this is a surprise even to the Trump camp. We're gonna we can talk more about that in a minute. We're gonna take another break and be back with more after this.
I'm Chanel Jones, live in the NBC News Washington Bureau. Voting in the historic 2016 election has now ended with polls closing in the state of Alaska. The vote there is not yet in, and the presidential race at this hour is still not decided, but Donald Trump seems to have a clear path to victory and what has been a dramatic upending of the polls that had tilted toward Hillary Clinton. Donald Trump is now leading in three states that were assumed to be Clinton's strongholds. Look at this, Wisconsin, the state of Michigan, and the state of Pennsylvania. Clinton was also hoping to flip the state of Arizona, but is trailing there as well. That's where we find Gadi Schwartz. Gadi, I don't need to ask you how the mood is there.
Well, Chanel, it should have been jubilant here. This was the scene of a tremendous victory. A lot of the people in this room, a lot of the people that have been working out of this office have been working for 4 years to remove the sheriff of Maricopa County here in Arizona from office. Tonight they did that with a lot of grassroots organizing. This is Mi Familia Vota. They're here, but you can see the mood is definitely subdued tonight. I want to take you through a little bit of what they've been doing over the last few years, because it's very important. Very, very fascinating. This is one of about 13 or 14 different Latino organizations that have been doing a lot of the canvassing out in these areas, a lot of the voter registration drives. And they've been targeting Maricopa County. That's what this map is right here. It shows Maricopa County, and they were able to register 150,000 new voters in Maricopa County. And then we are starting to see those returns come in. Clearly, Sheriff Joe Arpaio seems to be losing to his challenger. So the people here are saying that seems to be their work coming to fruition. But when it comes to the presidential debate or the presidential election here, let me just pull this up. This is the Maricopa County site. It's showing 84% of precincts reporting right now, and you see Trump ahead 49%, Clinton trailing behind 45%. That's with 84% reporting here. This is from the Maricopa County's website. So those are some of the latest results that we're seeing. Clearly not enough to bridge that gap so far, but those results are still coming in here in Arizona. Chanel?
Gadi, this is fantastic. Very revealing. I'm looking at all of that work there behind you. It almost looks like they just evaporated. Where are they and what are they saying right now?
Well, a lot of them have gone home to talk to their family. It was a very sobering time to be here when they started to realize that Trump looked like he was pulling ahead of Clinton. And, you know, after talking to a lot of them, the reason why became very evident. A lot of these people joined this particular campaign. A lot of them called it the Basta Arpaio campaign, or Arpaio has to go campaign. And the reason why they did that is because family members had been deported. Family members had been targeted by the sheriff's department. So they wanted to get involved to see if they could undo some of that. They did so on the local level, but now watching the polls, they fear that they did not do that on the national level.
All right. Gadi Schwartz, thank you. Right over your shoulder there, it says, vote for your future. I don't have any words on that one. Thank you, Gadi. Joining me once again is Jennifer Lawless from American University.
That live shot was unbelievable. It's serious. I said evaporated, but it's true. It's just everybody disappeared.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Hillary Clinton campaign and her supporters and her surrogates are ending the night a lot differently than they began the day. We saw pictures of women taking their daughters to vote, wearing pantsuits, wearing white to celebrate the likelihood of electing the first female president. And it seems like that's not going to happen.
We have a little bit of time left. If we can, let's take a live look at what's going on right now at Hillary Clinton's party there at the Javits Center in New York City. Look at this. There were so many people who thought that they were going to see the first woman president tonight.
Right, and the Javits Center actually has a glass ceiling, so there was symbolism behind the location as well, and it just doesn't look like it's going to be shattered.
I remembered, I'm looking at a quote here. She said when she was conceding to Barack Obama in 2008, she said, you know, although we weren't able to shatter that highest, hardest glass ceiling at this time, she said, thanks to you, it's got about 18 million cracks in it. Then she went on to say, and the light is shining through like never before, filling us with all the hope and the sure knowledge that the path will be a little easier next time. That next time is tonight.
Well, it was. She won the nomination this time, which she did not win in 2008. But it seems like she fell short and is not going to be occupying the Oval Office.
Jennifer, you've had a long day with us. Thank you for talking with me this evening. Tonight, in the only poll that counts, Election Day, the voters have spoken, giving Donald Trump a clear edge in the race for the presidency, giving Republicans control of the House and the Senate, also leaning towards a Republican majority. We now throw it back to Lester Holt in our New York studios for continuing coverage of Decision Night in America.
Welcome back. It is 1:30 in the morning on the East Coast, and we are still watching the race to 270. Right now, Donald Trump hanging on to a 244 to 215 lead over Hillary Clinton. There you see the map laid out. We are still waiting for those states in gray to help give us an answer. Here's where we're at already this evening, though. The states you're looking at, Donald Trump has already won, according to our projections. And then we'll put up there on the side of Rock Center Hillary Clinton's face. And you'll see the states that she has won tonight. All right, we want to go to the White House right now. And that's where Ron Allen is standing by. And Ron, I'm told you've had a bit of a crowd gathered there tonight.
We have, Lester. There are several hundred people out here who have gathered. This was supposed to be an anti-Trump rally, but talking to the many students out here, there are some people who are supporting Trump, some who are supporting Hillary Clinton. The people up there in the tree that you see, we believe that they are Trump supporters. They are happy, and the people who are downcast are Clinton supporters. They are disappointed. They are stunned. They are surprised by what's happening, but they have not given up hope. Over there, of course, you see the White House, and we believe the president and the first family are there. We do not expect to hear from the president tonight. The guidance was that we would probably hear from him once the dust is settled, once there is definitely an outcome, and perhaps that's going to happen tomorrow. But you have to wonder, what is President Obama thinking and feeling tonight, given the effort that he put into trying to get Hillary Clinton into the White House, and given the fact that it may be Donald Trump, the man who led the birther movement, who questioned his very legitimacy, who may follow him into the White House. President Obama was in Michigan, he was in Florida, he was in North Carolina, on the trail, ridiculing Donald Trump. And months ago, he said, the president did, that Donald Trump will not become president of the United States. Well, we'll see what happens as the vote count continues to play out tonight. But again, out here tonight, a lot of energy, a lot of people who are trying to take in what has happened. This has been just a stunning night. There are several hundred people out here. It's all peaceful. The Secret Service are here. They're watching this. There's already the setup here, this fence that you can see over here, that's set up for the inaugurational ceremony that happens in a couple of months. But again, we're here outside of the White House, a peaceful vigil, a lot of young people gathered waiting to see how all this plays out. Lester, back
all
to
right,
you.
Ron Allen, with quite a crowd there for this time of the morning outside the White House. Thanks very much. Before I go to the panel, Chuck, just for those who are flipping back and forth,
Yeah. This
you may be listening to this and thinking we're talking about a foregone conclusion. There is still a path to victory for Hillary Clinton here.
It's very narrow. I mean, I'll be honest. I don't see there's two things that two problems she's got is Pennsylvania and Wisconsin here. Both of them look like they're trending Trump. I think we're pretty close to Wisconsin just seems totally out of reach. Pennsylvania, we're going to wait till everything comes in, but he's got about a 50, what is he up to? That's the Wisconsin. Let's look at Pennsylvania. He's got a 58,000 vote lead, and, you know, there's no Philadelphia left. There's no big sections left. She can still win Michigan, but they may not matter. Pennsylvania plus Wisconsin, done deal.
We think we know where this is going.
Barring some... I say this because I'll never forget what happened in 2000 in Florida and the missing 50,000, literally a 50,000 vote switch.
Hey, you keep talking about buckets of votes.
No, because that one was.
We all have PTSD.
That's right.
I got them right.
I remember the military votes.
Right.
I mean,
right. That one was like a miss, frankly, was like a typo by somebody and a clerk. But 50, you know, if we were at 5,000.
Is more than a bucket.
Yeah, if we had 5,000 votes, 4,000 vote difference, you would sit there and say that. 58,000 votes is, you know, that's the story here. It's the rural areas of the big blue wall.
You may have noticed on the end of the table here, we've added Richard Engel, our chief foreign correspondent. Richard, you're spending a lot of your time overseas. You know what they folks say about they're amazed, obviously, by the American political process. What are you hearing tonight? What are you reading?
Well, let's just cut to the chase. Assuming, and that's what we're talking about, that he does win, people I'm speaking to think it's absolutely catastrophic. That it's catastrophic for the United States, that it's catastrophic for our position in the world. It emboldens our enemies and adversaries. It makes our allies terrified that we're not going to be their allies anymore. Most people think that this type of scenario happens, that if you imagine the United States as a nuclear warship, we stop. We become totally focused on our own domestic politics, that he's going to provoke a constitutional crisis. He's going to get into a fight with the Supreme Court. There'll be attempts to impeach him. And that for 6 months to a year or longer, we will be navel gazing. We will not be leading the world. And other powers, Russia, China, adjust around us.
He has called our generals stupid. He has advocated.
Let me tell you, the general is reading the Constitution.
I'm sorry, say it again?
I've been talking to generals for a long time. They've been reading the Constitution to see what they are obligated to do if they are really ordered to round up and deport millions of Americans and put them on buses or trains. Do they have to do that? The president is the commander in chief. That's the stage what we're talking about. Do they have to follow what they would believe would be an immoral and illegal order? So you have to look at this as a transformative event with America's role, not just domestically, but internationally.
Let me throw this at you. The national intelligence, the White House, everyone has agreed that the Russians have taken an active role in this election. Because it's a political thing, it sometimes gets overlooked, But that's if you take this election out of the equation and Russians interfering with any American process, it's a frightening picture.
Well, if you look at the world, right? We used to live in a world with two great superpowers. And with the collapse of the Soviet Union, we're now left with the United States being the only remaining superpower. Well, that has its advantages and its disadvantages. The advantages, and also its disadvantage, that no other state can do as much harm to you as you can do to yourself, right? And it seems to be that that is what the United States is doing right now. And Russia, as the last superpower, decided that a way to regain its empire, to regain its position in the world, was to help undermine the political system. And I've been to Russia, I've spoken to hackers there, we've spoken to intelligence communities. They had no doubt that Russia was deeply involved in helping to undermine Hillary Clinton. They also expect that Russia has been stockpiling information on Trump. Clearly, Trump has done a lot of business there. He's an easier target. We know, and we've talked about all the scandals. So wouldn't it make sense that if Russia now would want to unleash all of the material
That's
speculative, though. But okay. Not based on my speculation. Yeah. That's based on speculation of people who've been examining this, including cyber experts who have been investigating Russia's role, that they have material on Trump, that they would be it would behoove them to unleash it in order to hobble him, in order to hobble us, in order to hobble the only remaining superpower.
All Russia cares about is us staying out of their way.
Imagine
us. This is what they want.
We're a nuclear ship. Yeah. We stop. Steam comes out of the middle. Russia, China, they do what they want. Russia, speaking of ships, has just moved its ship off the coast of Syria and is expected to start bounding Aleppo tomorrow, Eastern Aleppo. Do you think we're going to be talking about that?
Do we know what his plan? He's talked about a plan in Syria.
I'm sorry. Because the Chinese have got military stuff going on as well, Lester. They're moving out of China across the South China Seas and into the Middle East. I mean, they've got a whole pathway going there at that point.
If we make ourselves irrelevant, others will step into the gap.
Yeah. What are they saying in Turkey, and what are they saying in Israel, and what are they saying in the Middle East about what happens in that cauldron of the world right now?
Well, can I tell you something? I wasn't surprised by this outcome. I actually thought this was going to happen because it fits a trend. And you're seeing this trend in Turkey, in the Philippines, in Egypt, in with Brexit, where you're having, even in Iceland, where you're having right-wing or fringe candidates emerging to the forefront. It's been a pattern. And where you have these populist leaders who are effectively doing what they want, appealing directly to the people, going through social media, going through the television. And okay, if this happens in the Philippines, it's bad for that country. If it happens to the United States, it's terrible for everybody. So that's what they're seeing. They're seeing it as this part of this larger pattern of fringe candidates and right wing.
This is upbeat.
Yeah.
I don't mean to be like, I'm sitting here, I mean, you're painting a frightening picture, Richard, and I
wish I wasn't.
I was driving back to what Savannah said, which is the weight of the office. Will he understand the responsibility he has as?
I'm not a psychiatrist, but
as Europe's safety net. I mean, Europe right now has got to be freaking out.
Well, clearly, he has spoken in very negative terms about our obligations to NATO. And one thing in seeing Republicans reelected to the Senate, like John McCain, who are strong voices around the world on some of his closest friends are the leaders of countries that rely on a clear voice from the United States of America. I mean, he will have a check in some of those senators and in some
Isn't
of the...
Isn't that ironic? Yeah. Because there was so much talk about, Hillary Clinton will win.
Right.
We need Republicans in the Senate to be a check. It may be fall to a John McCain,
on foreign
Lindsey
policy?
Graham, and a lot of these...
On foreign policy, Hillary Clinton was much more in line with a foreign policy view of the Republican establishment. She understood and valued our commitments around the world. She understood and valued the importance of...
Republican establishment?
Well,
it just
the Republicans still control the Senate.
Well, I hear you, except Donald Trump, the country has spoken, and the Republican primary voters spoken. They rejected the Republican establishment, and now they rejected the Washington establishment as a whole, the American political establishment throwing us in the media. So I hear you, but what kind of check? I go back to Donald Trump won this on his own.
Completely.
To the point where people, one newspaper in this country endorsed him.
The National Enquirer.
One. Well, I was counting Las Vegas Review-Journal, the Sheldon Adelson
two.
Paper.
Well, I think you're going to hear more voices coming out and saying he didn't win it on its own. And I think that there's going to be more voices emerging.
Saying Russia?
I'm saying there are going to be a lot of attention
Assange?
Focused on Russia, on Assange. And we're going to be tying ourselves in knots. We're going to be fighting over the Constitution. We're going to be fighting over the Supreme Court. Was Russia involved? And then proving that it was involved through hacking is a very complicated task. So I just see us not sitting back and saying, okay, well, let's the American people have spoken. We're just going to hope for the best, and maybe that once he walks into the Oval Office, he'll have some epiphany that he needs to be responsible.
Could he undo the Iran deal?
Yeah, very. Of course he could.
But the fact is, Richard, the first half of your statement is a correct one. He has power because the American people gave it to him. And he didn't go to them with one set of values and then change to another. He stayed true to who he was, however much anyone may disagree with any of that. They bought into that. That's what they wanted. They thought that's what Washington needed to see. They also thought it's what the world needed to see.
They keep seeing that when the market crashes and when other things happen. There was the Brexit regret that happened afterwards.
Oh, I understand that. I get that. But I'm telling you, that's the reality of where we are. That's the system that we have. People get to make a choice about who their leaders are. Then the leaders have to decide what kind of leaders they want to be. And it doesn't come from outside. It really comes from inside who they are and the kind of value that are imparted to those leaders by the people who put them in that office. Look, I've got grave reservations. You and I have talked about this a lot, about what kind of an international leader he'll be, about how much he understands how complex all of this is, because he's a guy who, went through the primaries shooting from the hip. worked for him very well politically. We've seen other people go into that office and be overwhelmed by it, quite honestly, because from the moment you step in, the problems come through the transom, under the door, through the windows, 24/7. And you've got to have great staffs, and you have to have a very sophisticated system for dealing with all that. Is he up to that? Does he care about it? I don't know. But in the meantime, he does have the power of the people behind.
Let's get the read over at the Clinton gathering right now. Andrea Mitchell is standing by. Andrea, are you hearing anything from the inner circle, the Clinton folks, as to what their read and how this evening is going to play out, whether we will even have an answer tonight?
They have really gone silent. Now, there's a lot of anticipation here that there has to be some kind of announcement. For one thing, this building is not supposed to be open all night. There are a lot of people here. They've been waiting. Many have left, but many, many more are here. This is a very large facility, larger than you could even see from our camera angles. That said, there's a number of calculations involved. Hillary Clinton won her Senate race in 2000, the night that Al Gore arguably conceded too soon, leading to all of the backtracking and the recount. I was with her that night. There was a lot of drama and a lot of second guessing about whether Al Gore should not have said what he said initially, and then, of course, he took it back. And then he was incredibly gracious, of course, when it was all over. But that sort of began the process. So I think what's likely going on is, first of all, them trying to determine whether any of these states are within the automatic recount margin of error that would trigger an automatic recount. If not, and if it's a done deal, then they have to make a concession speech. And then what kind of concession speech? She has said the most categorically terrible things about Donald Trump. And the fact that she has said that he's unqualified, that he is a misogynist, that he is racist, all of these things she said about him, how does she now say, the people have spoken, I will cooperate, I will do what is helpful and what is best for the country, when she thinks that he should not be president of the United States? That said, just last night, she told 33,000 people in Philadelphia that Donald Trump was attacking democracy by saying that he wouldn't concede. So if she's true to her own principles, she has to make a concession.
Yeah, that's a little hard to dial back on, and there's a phone call that would precede that speech as well.
And by the way, we live in a vacuum on election nights, but there are other news organizations that have already moved some states that we haven't called yet, Pennsylvania, into Trump. And, you know, again, we haven't done it simply because there is so much raw vote that you're just extraneous and you're always nervous when it's this close, and you want to be careful, especially when you're calling the presidency. There's no doubt about it. But, you know, she needs a miracle, I think, at this point to get to.
I think they may have pulled back Pennsylvania. You know, I think the AP may have pulled Pennsylvania back.
That one got a lot on the right fired up.
But I think they may have pulled it.
Well, that would be the end of the
I think Andrea's got something else she wants to add. Andrea?
Yeah, we understand that campaign chairman John Podesta has left the hotel, and he did say to a reporter outside, we are going over to the Javits. So I think you can expect that at the very least, John Podesta is coming over here, but I think it may be the Clintons as well. Now, if there's some issue of Pennsylvania and of the outcome of Pennsylvania and what the Associated Press reported, which we, of course, have not, that might change that. But as of moments ago, John Podesta was headed over this way. They have to say something publicly. And there has been a game of chicken, if you will. We know that Donald Trump was eager to come out and say something, but clearly no one wants to be the one to go first here. So I expect that we're going to hear something from the Clintons.
Yeah,
you can only imagine how devastating this is.
Washington Post does have Pennsylvania.
We should look, his lead's up to 80,000. Again, I've heard from a Clinton person, as you can see, there's 77,000. They're talking about it. They claim there's some irregularities and things like that, and so I assume that's what they're going to try to go through.
But who thought that it would be the Clinton campaign at 1:47 a.m. talking about irregularities? Right. I mean, it was never.
Who doesn't love irony? I mean, it's all over this election. But the big one of the biggest controversies and moments is in this campaign is when Trump
said he might.
I might not concede. And now it's almost 2 a.m. on the East Coast, and there's some hand wringing about how and when Hillary Clinton might concede. So now she's on the business end of all of the arguments she made.
It's such a stunning turn of events. And his overt message was to run against a rigged system, a rigged media, a rigged political class, Democrat and Republicans, and to run against sort of the Clinton machine. And that it's now the Clinton campaign you're hearing from about irregularities in a state where he has an 80,000 vote lead is just something. But 4 hours ago, I would have found stunning.
It's 80,000 votes. This is not.
But isn't that a reason?
It's not 5,000 votes.
Isn't that a reason for concern? If he managed to pull off this miraculous defeat, this almost unprecedented, unpredicted event, and he comes out and gives this speech, "We did it," even though the media was against us, even though nobody said we could do it, thanks to you. I would think he's going to feel incredibly emboldened to try and go as far as he can.
Do you think the result? What are you suggesting?
He now has the Senate majority back as well. I mean, that's the other thing.
Look, this is a
Republican House, Republican Senate, and the White House. Trumpian White House. I don't know.
I mean,
you know.
I guess this is our modern day Dewey defeats Truman. It was practically that.
We don't like to talk to about ourselves in this context. But let's face it, we were as much on the ballot, we, the media, as anything else. There was a great joy, I think, in among some to put a stick a thumb in our eyes because of the perception.
Definitely.
But to your point, it was an applause line at every single event. Mm-hmm. Our own correspondents were bullied and heckled by the Republican nominee.
I can tell you time after time, and we've spoken about this, there were stories that you wanted to lead with something else, but then he would do something that was just No candidate had gone before. Provocative.
First of all, that was the one unifying theme of this campaign, that everyone hates the media, whether you're a Hillary supporter or a Trump supporter. So, kumbaya,
working until 2 in the morning. I'm not feeling great about the media.
I got Bernie Bros going. See, this is why you guys should have given Bernie more airtime.
How much did that propel him? Did he become a hero of the anti?
It
media
was part
and,
of his
and,
soup.
And
I mean, he made sort of a, some people might find it a toxic brew, depending on your perspective. His supporters, and I know a lot of them, found it to be sort of a magic recipe where you got his base riled up about enough things. You know, we talked about foreign policy a minute ago. He won the South Carolina Republican primary after blaming 9/11 on George W. Bush. I mean, the ideas are so outside the mainstream, not of Republican foreign policy, but of American foreign policy.
I think we do bear some of the responsibility, frankly.
The appeal of Trump is that he is that protest vote. Yeah. That's it. Look, this business about the Access Hollywood tape, this is not media interpreting. It's on the tape. You can hear it. The fact that he didn't turn in his taxes, it's right there. The fact that he's running as a businessman, and claimed an almost $1 billion loss in 1 year. He never denied it. But I think what the people are saying is, we don't care. We hear what you say about him. We don't want to hear it.
It made him stronger.
We don't care.
I don't think
it's not that it isn't true. It's that they don't care.
I mean, yes, it's true. A lot of the coverage, particularly over the last several months against Trump, has been incredibly negative. So you could say, well, what are we talking about? Why should you blame the media? There were so many stories that were negative. There is that old adage, all publicity is good publicity.
And we gave him a lot of publicity. And we know
he talked constantly about himself. Mm-hmm. So if you believe that all publicity is good publicity, and he clearly did, well, he got a lot of it.
I got a close friend of mine who's pretty smart about all this, who said, sometimes you got to remember, you all are trying to figure it out, and you're trying to figure out, well, he did this and he did this. That sometimes the American public does swoon. For reasons, they swooned. And his theory was, hey, they swooned. Obama seemed like the in thing to do, mm-hmm. and being for Trump seemed like the rebellious in thing to do. Mm-hmm. And maybe the country doesn't know what it's done yet, mm-hmm. but it rode a wave, and Trump was kind of captured the imagination.
Yeah.
And look, Hillary Clinton didn't do anything to capture the imagination. We've talked about it. It was always described as a grind. her campaign.
Yeah. Zanger shifts to her. By the way, you can also say voters are rewarding authenticity. Mm-hmm. I mean, here you have Donald
unscripted.
Trump, who talked about himself more than any other thing, but you know, in a way, I guess he gets points for candor. Mm-hmm. He's not one of these politicians that acts like I care about you. He makes it pretty clear that Donald Trump is number one in his life, and
he's an out-of-the-closet narcissist.
Appreciated the authenticity of it.
Selena Zito wrote a great column, and Steve Schmidt reminded me of it downstairs, where she wrote that the elites took him literally but not figuratively, and his supporters never took him literally, they took him figuratively. So this divide in how he was perceived, you know, the voters just cut him a lot of slack. They didn't think that any of the toxic kind of racially tinged comments were literal. They thought he was just putting it all out there as a provocateur. We all had, you know, our hair on fire, we still do. But I think that he sort of mainlined his message to the voters, he totally bypassed the media, and they delivered tonight's result, what we think will be tonight's
Savannah,
result.
Savannah, you got a Senate call?
I do, actually. We have a couple of them. Okay, so we're going to start in Pennsylvania, I believe. Senator Pat Toomey returns. So this is a hold for Republicans. Big deal because we're watching Pennsylvania so closely. So read that tea leaf if you like. Katie McGinty went down to defeat. And in Missouri, let's take a look. Another hold, Roy Blunt did not beat an upstart Democrat that a lot of folks were hoping would make a move in a deep red state. Jason Kander, who arguably had the best television ad, a veteran. I think we all remember the ad in Missouri where he was blindfolded and assembled an automatic rifle to say, hey, I've got the same bona fides that you care about in this state, but he goes down to defeat. So here we go. We called early on an Illinois pickup for Democrats, and that was many hours ago. And yes, it looks like senators are going to hang on. We still have this close race in New Hampshire. Chuck, you're the one who does the math so well. Oh, vote margin. It's there for us.
Put it up there for you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Please don't make me do math at this hour.
Well, that's fine. We're not making you do it.
Let's put it up on the New Hampshire Senate. Maggie Hassan, the governor, Kelly Ayotte, one of the most hotly contested races, one of the most expensive ones, 1,000 vote margin.
By the way, presidential and this race are essentially identical. So. Hillary Clinton has about 2,000 vote lead in New Hampshire right now.
But everybody at this table who thought at this part of the evening we would be saying tonight is a slam dunk for the Republicans, raise your hands, please.
Nobody said
no one did.
No one had to crawl into the table. Nobody
thought that. Not even the Wall Street Journal thought it was going to be a slam dunk for the Republicans.
Can I raise another issue, and that would be the U.S. Supreme Court? There's already one opening, and who knows how many potentially more over the next 4 years. And this is, the thought is that this is what drove a lot of Republican voters ultimately drove them home, because that's the biggie.
Especially evangelicals.
It'll be curious to see what the Democrats do as a minority party and decide, do they play the filibuster? Do they make the Republicans have to do the nuclear option? The question is, do they go tit for tat, right? On one hand, they criticize the Republicans for playing this game for a year. Now that the shoes are on the other foot, what do the Democrats semi-cooperate? Mm-hmm. Or do they say, no, you know what, you held up our guy, we're going to hold up yours. We're going to make you change the rules of the Senate to make it a 50-person vote. Although, I actually think secretly conservatives would love that, because that would allow them to get even more conservative justices in on a 50+1 vote.
But the Supreme Court is such an interesting question. I mean, the campaign drove the message. I don't think anyone here who's watched Donald Trump's sort of archival interviews believes that he's an ideological person. He was so pro-choice, he wasn't against partial birth abortion, I think, 3 years ago. So, I mean, the idea that the Supreme Court may have put him over the edge is so ironic, again, because he's not an ideological person. He's become pro-life, and obviously evangelical voters accepted that. But the notion that it was the Supreme Court and the culturally divisive issues that really helped him is just...
Wouldn't he have an ideology?
Power?
Maybe, but that doesn't, you know, the idea that he might adhere to something looser, you know, I just don't know what it is.
That's
about anything he's done.
That's not a constitutional ideology.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Hey.
Well, but with Supreme Court picks, what each side is usually looking for is ideological purity. And so that was such a salient issue is fascinating to me. This is a guy that, even in the general election, was talking about how important Planned Parenthood was. And I'm, you know, a lot of people were heartened to hear that he's not a particularly ideological guy. But it just makes the Supreme Court such an interesting issue for him to have gained such an advantage.
He had produced a list of people at one point.
He did, and that gave a lot of Republicans comfort, because there were some very conservative judges who were on that list.
But no one thought he knew who any of the names
were.
No, but that was fine, I think, right? I mean, I think well, like, Mitch McConnell, as long as you're putting the right names on right. there, we're good.
And Mitch McConnell said that one piece of paper was enough for him, and he then, I think within days of that list coming out, endorsed him.
It wasn't just any Supreme Court justice seat. It's Justice Scalia's right. seat. And it would have altered the balance. Exactly. I mean, we've seen epic Supreme Court fights, but in the last few years, they haven't been ones that would have altered that ideological balance. This one had the potential to.
And then it was to his advantage. It's just another interesting twist.
Let's get out to the Trump headquarters where Katie Turr is standing by. Katie, you know, we note, of course, you were there when he announced, what was that, 511 or maybe now 12 days ago. How off guard, how surprised are they right now that they're doing as well as they're doing?
Well, I can tell you, I had a very early conversation with a top campaign aide, gosh, maybe in early July of 2015, and they told me that they see their chances as 1 in 10 back then. 1 in 10 chance of getting the Republican nomination, let alone getting to the point that they're at right now. Those chances grew as time went on. Certainly from what I could see, the first rally, the really big rally that I went to, was in Phoenix, Arizona, where 5,000 people showed up. Donald Trump said 7,000, 10,000, 20,000, which wasn't true, but it was still quite a large crowd. And then when he criticized John McCain, called him not a war hero, criticized an American veteran who had been revered by so many, and then didn't drop in the polls, that's when a lot of Republicans started to wonder what was going on. And it's also when the Trump campaign was starting to feel like, wait a minute, we might actually be tapping into something here. We might really have a chance. That's when the protest campaign, which is really how this started to become something more real, something that would move forward. And Donald Trump kept getting those large rallies in state after state. By November, he had Secret Service protection right after Thanksgiving, and that was a real indication that he was a serious contender who was being taken very seriously, at least on one end of the political spectrum. Republicans were still wanting to count him out. They believed that ultimately the silly season would end, that Republican voters would come around and choose somebody more serious. They talked about Ted Cruz's ground game. They talked about Marco Rubio's perceived depth on foreign policy, Jeb's legacy and his vaulted infrastructure that he had around him and the funding that he had, Jeb Bush, that is. But none of those happened, and Donald Trump won the nomination and is now primed to potentially win the presidency.
All right, we've got Katie, thank you. We have another projection to make as we go to the side of Rock Center. And NBC News projects when all the votes are counted that Hillary Clinton will win the state of Maine, and she will get 3 of the 4 electoral votes there. They allocate them differently in Maine, but there's the raw vote count, 309,289, 48 to 45. So Hillary Clinton picking up another state. That brings her total on the electoral map there to 218 to the 245. For Donald Trump, neither still in reach of the 270 needed to secure the presidency. All right, Steve Schmidt, you just popped in next to me. I didn't even see you again. Good to see you. A campaign veteran. How will Democrats, assuming Hillary Clinton loses here, where will the finger pointing be?
Well, you don't really know where to begin. I mean, first off, you will have the Democratic Party out of power with all three houses, the Senate, the Congress, very weak bench, a massive repudiation personally of Secretary Clinton by the electorate. It will have been a close election, but Republicans will have 100% of the political power here. And right away, they're going to have the votes to repeal and replace Obamacare, to dismantle Dodd-Frank. I think you're going to see really fast action. You'll see Donald Trump on day one dismantle the architecture of the executive orders.
Let me cut you off a second. We need to go back to the Clinton headquarters. We understand John Podesta has just walked in the room. Andrea Mitchell, is he going to speak?
Yes, he is going to speak. We understand that this is not going to be a final statement. The friends, the donors, the supporters have all reassembled. The other people here, the large crowd has been here. The music came back up. And here is the announcement for John Podesta. It will not be the Clintons.
Thank you. Well, folks, I know you've been here a long time, and it's been a long night, and it's been a long campaign. But I could say we can wait a little longer, can't we? We're still counting votes, and every vote should count. Several states are too close to call, so we're not going to have anything more to say tonight. So listen. Listen to me. Everybody should head home. You should get some sleep. We'll have more to say tomorrow. I want you to know, I want every person in this hall to know, and I want every person across the country who supported Hillary to know, that your voices and your enthusiasm mean so much to her and to Tim and to all of us. We are so proud of you. And we are so proud of her. She's done an amazing job, and she is not done yet. So thank you for being with her. She has always been with you. I have to say this tonight. Good night. We will be back. We'll have more to say. Let's get those votes counted, and let's bring this home. Thank you so much for all of you have done. You are in all of our hearts. Thank you.
Campaign Chairman John Podesta addressing the crowd gathered at the Jacob Javits Center on behalf of Hillary Clinton, saying, every vote should count. We can wait a little longer, and essentially telling the crowd to go home. It's not going to happen tonight. There will be no speeches tonight. Andrea Mitchell, did you see that coming?
What I was suggesting to you just a bit ago was that Hillary Clinton saw what happened with Al Gore, and until every vote is counted, especially given her verbal indictment going all the way back, but certainly in that San Diego foreign policy speech last summer, the fact is she has said he is not qualified to be commander-in-chief, that he is not qualified to hand the nuclear codes, that he is not qualified to run our military. It would be very difficult for her to concede until every vote is counted. That said, this contradicts everything she had said as recently as last night about being gracious and listening to the voters. But they're basically saying that there are some states that are still, they think, within the recount range, and they want to use every legal procedure that they can, and they're going to fight on, at least legally, as long as they can, as long as they think they have any argument.
Extraordinary role reversal. Let me ask around the table here. I mean, Donald Trump is a guy that doesn't play by the rules, so what's the betting that he comes out?
I assume he comes out.
By the way, if I were him, I would. He's leading in Pennsylvania, leading in Michigan, and leading in Wisconsin. He only has to win two of the three. And he gets his number one. He can win both Wisconsin and Michigan. Dante Cheney, our data guy, He's now run out of a path for her to carry Michigan, and it looked like it was, but there's Wayne County didn't turn out.
So does he come out? Does he just come out and declare victory or something near victory?
I hope not. Look, there's a choreography to this in our system, and I was critical of Donald Trump earlier in the campaign, but now the burden will likely fall on Secretary Clinton here to commence the process where we transfer power peacefully in this country. And that begins with a concession phone call. And the first person who will address Donald Trump in the next hours is Mr. President-elect, who matters, is Secretary Clinton. And I think the choreography, the ritual of that phone call, there have been concessions that have extended into the next day, into the next afternoon in elections, and this will probably be one of those.
What we don't know is if any phone call transpired.
Well, clearly not yet.
Not yet, yeah. And most people seem to be heading for the exits, but there are long, sad phases here, because even though John Podesta is correct that it's not over, every vote should count, clearly the folks in that room have been watching what we've all been watching here, and that path to victory all but closed.
Look, there is, if we were talking about one state,
where they needed to find a counting error or missing this or a precinct here. But she needs it in three states.
But just
right
imagine
now.
If the tables were turned and it was Trump refusing to concede at this moment under these circumstances.
But by the way, I wouldn't. You wouldn't actually expect him. I mean, look, it is the presidency. It has happened. Mm-hmm. Again, she is trying to do something we've never seen, which is find that missing, that whatever it is, that in three states where she's down essentially anywhere from a half a percentage point to a percentage point.
And of course, at the end of the night, she could still win the popular vote, which gets us back to that whole debate that comes up every 4 years or so on why do we do this Electoral College thing?
These are the rules you play by.
Exactly.
Yeah. These are the rules you play by. And everybody agreed to these rules.
Exactly, but it comes up.
Try amending the Constitution. You think a presidential election is hard.
Yeah. That ratification would go well. Let's go to Katie Turr at the Trump headquarters. Katie, are they aware of what John Podesta just said? Has that word...
The crowd is aware of what John Podesta just said because they watched it on the monitors here. I have reached out to the campaign to find out if they plan on coming out now that they've seen Podesta basically tell his crowd to go home and they're not going to make a decision tonight for the Clinton campaign, and I still have not heard back. What I suspect is going on behind the scenes is conversations about whether Donald Trump should come out and decide that he is going to declare himself the winner, or is he going to wait it out until they get officially to 270, at least wait for one news network to officially call him the winner and the president-elect at 270. You can hear this crowd behind me. They are yelling, call it, call it, call it. Obviously, people are getting quite tired. It's 2 a.m. in the morning, and many of them have been here for hours. The doors opened here at 3 p.m. Also, these are folks who have been waiting to see Donald Trump win the presidency, so they're feeling like they want this to happen as quickly as it can at this point. The Trump campaign, though, is not giving any indication of when he will come out. We do know that he does want to come out, and he has been preparing his remarks. But as of now, the last we heard, he is still waiting for 270.
All right, Katie, thanks very much. Chuck?
Steve. 2004. John Kerry did not concede the night of. Right. They thought there was enough in Ohio. And you guys did not declare victory.
We did not.
Either. You made the decision, you know what, we'll give Kerry, if he wants a day, give him a day.
Absolutely. You know, give him time. You know, look, the psychological impact of this is that, you know, I think not only all of us, but, you know, certainly everyone on the Clinton campaign went into the Peninsula Hotel today believing that she would be the president-elect of the United States sometime before midnight. That hasn't happened. So, you know, giving your opponent some time to get used to the new reality is an okay thing to do.
All right, Savannah's got a Senate call here.
Let's make it official. The Republicans hold the Senate. Lisa Murkowski in Alaska holds on. Here she is. This is not a surprise, but puts a fine point on the night. It is a Republican night, and if everything turns out the way I think we anticipate that it will, the Senate stays in Republican hands, the House we know, and it looks like Donald Trump will be president-elect.
This is already a more powerful congressional majority than George W. Bush. In fact, it was basically a 50-50 Senate when he came into office in 2000. This is, again, I mean, he's got, if he wants to govern with the congressional majority, he's got the ability to do it. We're all just, I think everybody is trying to figure out how does that going
well,
to work?
Well, they all are going to have they have an R by their
let me
name.
Make it quickly make another mean? Projection, and it is the state of Alaska. NBC News projects that Donald Trump will win in the state of Alaska, 3 electoral votes. It increases his margin by 3, but does not get him to that 270. Here's how it shakes out in Alaska, 54% to 37. Trump over Clinton right now in Alaska. And if we come down to the rink and look at that race to 270, it inches Trump closer, but not quite there. 248, 218 for Hillary Clinton. And look at that map, a sea of red. With Illinois kind of breaking it up there in the middle.
Lester, he leads in Arizona, 11. He leads in Pennsylvania. He leads in Michigan. He leads in Wisconsin. She does lead in Minnesota and New Hampshire. But, you know, any combination of those four, of his four leads should I believe, does it.
Well, Kevin Tibbles is in Michigan. He can count some of the votes there for us, or the people around him. Kevin?
Well, you know, Lester, this has been such an incredible roller coaster ride evening here in Grand Rapids. Yes, we are in Gerald Ford country here, but I can tell you from talking to the several hundred people who were here earlier, obviously the crowd has thinned out as it is right across the country. But people here are just sort of flabbergasted by what has taken place with regards to this election this evening. I spoke to some people who said when they had their first sort of Trump organizational meeting, you know, you could have held it in a phone booth here in Grand Rapids. And now this evening, last night, Mr. Trump had more than 4,000 people in the local convention center here after midnight. So things have really changed here. I can honestly say, and I'm looking across the room, that people are very surprised, and I'm getting a nod that it has gone down this way. But at the end of the day, I think that people here are flat out exhausted, Lester, with the you know, it reminds me of the Cubs last week, to be honest with you. I mean, how many innings is this thing gonna go tonight, Lester?
And in the same week, we saw the end of daylight saving time. So none of us is getting enough sleep right now, at least on this end. Savannah, I was going to say the morning papers are probably being produced even as we speak. But we'll hear a lot of talk about Brexit.
Yes.
And drawing the comparison.
Well, on a couple of levels. I mean, first, because Brexit was a complete rejection of conventional wisdom and what the establishment thought should happen. This is the voters of Great Britain deciding to pull out of the European Union, and that was a political earthquake. And then also, many people felt that the polls got it wrong. I think if you look a little more deeply into that, it might have been the analysis of the polls that was an error. So we have a lot in common in the sense of, if this election turns out tonight as we are thinking it might, rejection of the establishment, polls that aren't getting it right, media conventional wisdom being rejected, it's all there if you want to make those connections. And Donald Trump has been making that connection himself, actually, from the stump quite a bit, saying we got a Brexit situation. He's been using it as something of a shorthand, a way of saying this is a moment where everything that all the people who are supposed to know everything assume is going to be turned on its head.
And of course, all of Brexit hasn't played out yet, but people could look over there and say, well, nothing seems like it's been upended.
Well, there was like this immediate regret that people felt palpably, and you did see the financial markets, and we already are seeing some of that happen, the Dow futures crashing, and you're seeing some of the overseas stock markets that are already open dropping significantly. But then there's also, as the months go on, you start to see that life goes on.
The world didn't end.
Yeah. And I think we're about to witness this in our own country. Yeah.
By the way, I find it fascinating. We talk about this rejection of the establishment. In every state, even the makeup of these states, Steve, if you've noticed, they're slightly different.
Yeah.
And, you know, it is very rural, urban. I mean, it's like, you know, she did, I look at Texas. She actually did it better than Texas than, you know, because she did well in urban areas.
Right.
But it's the rural vote that came out. It is every state essentially shows those that feel as if they were being left behind or condescended to or overlooked were totally, you know, by whatever the big city is in that state, you know, they voted Clinton and rural of X of that state said no.
By the way, so we saw some establishment senators get returned to office, Burr and Blunt, to name a couple. So it's not just as simple as that.
We're going to take a break, and if you've been flipping by, just to be clear, that the party has essentially ended at the what was the viewing party for the Clinton folks. John Podesta came out and said, go home, this isn't over. We want all the votes to be counted, but we're not going to do anything more tonight. So that's where we stand. We're still waiting on a number of states too close to call. We'll update you where we are right after this short break. It's 2:20 in the morning Eastern time. We're watching the cameras here at the Trump headquarters, trying to figure out if we are going to hear from anyone from the campaign, and certainly from Donald Trump himself. He's not crossed the 270 mark, and Hillary Clinton's folks have have left their viewing party, not certainly throwing in the towel because this isn't over, but we'll keep an eye on what's happening there at the Trump headquarters. And while we do that, let me go back over to Chuck Todd. Chuck, John Podesta said, look, you know, it's not over. They want to go through the votes. Tell us what they're looking at that gives them any hope.
All right. Tell you what we're looking at and why we haven't called Wisconsin. Two things. Number one, we still don't know what the total absentee vote is in Milwaukee. Until all precincts are reported in Milwaukee, then we will know what the absentee vote is, and then we will figure that out. There is a few precincts in Dane County, a big Clinton county. So again, our boiler room, they want to see all of that. They want to know that number, and that's why we haven't called those. Let me move over here to Michigan and explain where we are there. There's still some vote out in Detroit. Detroit works in Wayne County, works just like I described in Milwaukee. When all of the precincts are counted in Detroit and in Wayne County, then they tell us what the absentee vote is. But what I can tell you is we don't know what that number is, and our guys want to know what the number is until they feel comfortable making a decision one way or the other. But as you can see, it is a Trump lead there. And then let me take us over. I can work my way here. Let me take us over to Pennsylvania. Hopefully here, there it is. And here in Pennsylvania, again, between provisional ballots and the extraneous ones that are around, and we are in a 2012 map, sorry about that, on Pennsylvania, between the extraneous ballots and some provisional ballots, our folks don't think we'll be able to call Pennsylvania tonight. That you gotta know everything that's available. We know a few other news organizations have. Our guys don't want to do it, considering how many provisionals are out there.
Can Trump win without Pennsylvania, based on what's left?
My point is this. He can win, and let me back up here. He can win with any pairing, any combination. Look, he can win with just Pennsylvania and Arizona at this point. Look, he's 22 short. Okay, so both Wisconsin and Michigan would do it. I think Wisconsin looks a lot of all these. I think the biggest reach for Clinton is Wisconsin. We'll throw 10 in there. That's 258. So, you know, Michigan would put him over. I think he's come one short if he gets that one or Pennsylvania. So, look, I'll get to the what if here for us here in a minute, make sure it's all working well. But, you know, she's got to win all of them, as we said. He only needs one of them at this point. And that's, I mean, look, Pennsylvania puts him there. He just needs that. And Arizona would put him over the top. And he could lose both Wisconsin and Michigan. Or let's do that. Let's give her both of those. And then he could win Michigan and Wisconsin. The point is now, we've talked about all those paths that she had. Donald Trump's the one with all the paths.
Talk about a reversal of fortune.
Absolutely. He's the one with all the paths to 270.
But the fact is, those combinations are still possible, so we still wait, and that's why the Clinton folks have gone home. And the question is now, what will Donald Trump do? It would almost seem in character that he would want to come out now.
I have to say, I want to go back. Look, when they decided not to declare victory that night with John Kerry, we were talking about one state. You know, we are talking about three states here, and they basically, they need a miracle in two of those three of ballots that are missing or provisional ballots that come from, you know, where, or a bigger absentee vote than was expected. It's, you know, obviously you wait, but I can see why the Trump people are irritated.
Yeah. The Hillary Clinton had talked so much about healing today in her final remarks. And as Andrea pointed out, if she has to concede, it's, you almost wonder, what can she say in a healing way, given the way she has positioned herself against Donald Trump as an enemy of democracy and many other things?
Well, she's laid out the homework assignment pretty well, because she's been telling him what is required, what our democracy requires when there's a peaceful transfer of power. And so, she's going to have to find the words, if she finds herself in that situation, to be gracious, to put the country first, to say, this man is our president, all of our president. I mean, there's a script to follow, but I mean, these are not easy speeches to give. Steve Schmidt's the
spokesperson,
the
by the way.
Don't
mean to interrupt. Spokesperson for the Republican Party says, Donald Trump's about to take the stage at the Hilton in New York.
Let's go to Katie Turr then. Katie, are you hearing the same thing, that we're about to see Donald Trump on stage?
Yeah, I am. Donald Trump is in the building, and there is a bit of a frenzied atmosphere in this room right now. There is movement up on the balconies. The curtains are moving, and that is to say that there are people behind them. We did see a number of his aides line up a few minutes ago. They are no longer lining up, but now Secret Service is on either side of Donald Trump's podium. We are expecting him to come out. It is unclear at this point what Donald Trump will say. Will he declare victory? Will he chastise Hillary Clinton for not conceding? Will he chastise the news organizations for not calling it? This crowd has gotten quite rowdy. It is turned on the press. You can hear them yelling at times behind me, yelling at Fox News, which is standing right next to me, to call this race, and wondering why they are not doing it. Of course, Fox News is on the monitors here at headquarters. It is late. Many of these folks have been drinking. There are bars here, and they want to see their candidate come out, and they want to hear what he has to say. And what Donald Trump has to say, frankly, is anybody's guess. If I've learned one thing on the campaign trail for this last 17, 18 months, you can never predict what Donald Trump is going to do.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can appreciate certainly the restlessness of folks. I mean, they have seen this thing turn around in ways that not even members of the campaign could acknowledge.
Look, the right thing, the right way to handle this, if you're Donald Trump and you think you're going to be president of the United States, is to go out there. You thank everybody. It's close. We don't want to assume anything. And so we expect to be declared the winner soon, something like that. Can he restrain himself?
For a moment of grace.
That's right. This is his first presidential moment. How he handles this, it'll be an interesting test.
I remember having a conversation with him in New Hampshire at the beginning of all this, and I forget, he had said something that had raised eyebrows, and I remember asking the question that at some point will you switch into a presidential mode? I said it's hard for people to think of you saying what you said there with the presidential seal, you know, in front of you. And he acknowledged that, you know, there's a certain amount of showmanship, but that he in fact would. And we've seen moments along the campaign where he has, but then he reverts, you know, back to the primary Donald Trump.
Right. So, you're right. He says, I know how to be presidential.
There's just no question. I mean, he's treated this as a steel cage death match from the first hour that he descended the escalator. But now, is he capable of showing that level of restraint?
And what Chuck is saying, this could be that moment. This could be.
Look, he's going to have he's got a very divided country on his hands. He's going to have, in the same way, no matter which one of these candidates won tonight, they had a divided country on their hands. But he's got one, and that's going to feel more divided by race than perhaps there was an expectation. So look, he has got to realize he's president of 330 million people, not the 122 that may be voting for him.
You know, one of the interviews we saw earlier down in the plaza was with someone who said, you know, this is, you got to remember, this is in many ways more about Hillary Clinton than it was Donald Trump. The vote against.
I hear you. I'm not fully convinced.
Listen, I mean, there was a lot of hate, you know, generated mm-hmm. toward her. You don't think that would have.
There's no doubt, but these folks were gravitating towards Trump. Look who voted. If this were always anti-Hillary, then I think he would have done better in the suburbs. This was different. This is rural America. This is saying, you know what? Stop trying to leave us behind.
Yeah, it's like in some way it almost is beyond any one candidate. It's like who most effectively sends the message that we've had enough. And whoever that candidate is
whatever
the candidate that prevails.
By the way, what is enough?
It's just a massive.
You got to define that.
It's just a massive repudiation of institutions in this country.
Yeah. Katie, are you seeing any further movement?
We are seeing a number of his staff trickling in, staff from both Donald Trump's campaign and Governor Pence's campaign, also Donald Trump's organization. We really could be waiting any minute now for Donald Trump to take the stage. Just to reflect a little bit on how he has gotten here and the questions that still remain around Donald Trump, I think it's worth noting that he still hasn't addressed the conflict of interest between himself and his business. He said that he would hand it over to his kids and give it to them in a blind trust, but that's not quite how a blind trust works, especially since many of his holdings are so public and it's very clear to find out what would be going on with them. There's also an open investigation that Donald Trump still faces and fraud charges having to do with his university. There are also questions around surrounding his conduct with women alleging that he has groped them. He has gotten this far by defying political norms, by defying the system, by breaking the rules, not despite it, but by doing it. That's what his supporters have liked about him. Now, the question is, he has made some very big promises to them. He's promised that he is going to build a wall. He's promised that he would immediately end Obamacare. He's promised that he would tear up the Iran deal, get rid of the EPA. These are difficult things to get done alone. But Donald Trump could potentially and does actually have a Republican-controlled Senate and a Republican-controlled House if he were to win. That certainly would help him. But guys, this is a divided country right now. As much as he energized his own supporters, he revolted millions of Americans. And we saw this from city to city, especially in the more urban areas, especially the areas that were closer to the border with Mexico. Large crowds of people that would come out and protest defiantly, refusing to accept Donald Trump as a legitimate candidate and getting into confrontations with his supporters. We saw riot police in city after city in this country in the lead up to Donald Trump's nomination for the Republican Party. That died down a little bit after he won the nomination and after it seemed that many folks who supported Hillary Clinton just didn't see the prospect of Donald Trump actually winning to be plausible. I wonder what happens tomorrow if Donald Trump does in fact get to 270. What sort of reaction will those who felt disenfranchised by Donald Trump or targeted, by Donald Trump, what sort of reaction will they have tomorrow?
Yeah, there are so many ways this could fall out. I mean, think of all the Republican running for Senate who distance themselves from him, those who publicly were part of the Stop Trump movement. There's a saying about payback. How much will they see?
I think one of the things that's extraordinary about tonight, he's the first candidate poised to win who defeated two parties. Right? So he defeated the Democratic Party tonight, but also the Republican Party, the establishment of it. It lays in ruins. This is the party of Ronald Reagan and both President Bush's is no longer exists in America. It's something new. It's something very different. And as Katie said, that campaign has functioned far outside the normal boundaries of what's said, what's done, what's talked about in American politics.
By the way, he now is going to have a rationale to give a victory speech. There is one major news organization that has called the presidency. And so that is all he may be looking for, is one major news organization to do it. And one has in the Associated Press.
And we are guided by our decision desk, and they're not there. We
and
still
by the way,
have a number of states
that are... I stick by our guys because we've been... after going through the ringer in 2000, we are very careful.
The one thing John Podesta had right, we can wait until we see how this plays out.
No reason why you don't count the votes.
So, but the clearly there is a high sense of expectation. We do expect to hear from Donald Trump in some form or fashion here tonight. That party is just getting started. A lot of those folks who walked to that room tonight, they had seen the reports that we all had, the confidence in the Clinton campaign, the poll numbers that had her anywhere from 3 to 6 points ahead, multiple paths to 270, and we have watched here, 7-8 hours we've been out here, watch that all crumble apart in a reversal of fortune. It is Clinton who's been left with a singular path, if you will, to the 270. And right now we watch and wait. We look at the numbers. You keep seeing that these are the states that are all too close to call. Clinton holding on to a slight lead there in Minnesota. There's Wisconsin. Trump ahead, 49 to 46.
By the way, Trump didn't plan a big lavish bash for tonight. In fact, his aides were saying he didn't want to have a big bang-up party because he didn't want to jinx it. Meanwhile, the Javits Center is a huge convention center. Hillary Clinton, I mean, for a moment, I don't know what happened, but they were even going to have fireworks.
And their transition was in full gear.
Yeah.
I mean, there was coordination beginning with the White House already about how the rest of this week would play out, who would speak first, when she would have her. I mean, they were measuring the drapes.
And there's been certainly discussion about what a Trump cabinet would look like. We had Rudy Giuliani on a couple of hours ago, and he didn't bite when I asked him about what role he might have.
Is Christie in charge, at least nominally, of the Trump transition?
Oh, he's distanced himself somewhat.
He has not been as much of a factor and a force as he was early on.
The Bridgegate trial, his two aides that were convicted, he says he had nothing to do with it. They believe they're about to serve time after doing something they thought
that
their boss wanted.
Testimony in the trial
So that was a reason why he had been sort of staying away.
Nicole Wallace is back with us. You had a little insight into what a Trump cabinet might look like or some of the discussions.
Yeah, I think Governor Christie might have a different sense of his role. His role in the transition has been consistent. It's been behind the scenes. The transition on both sides is not something that plays out in full view of the public for the very reason of what we're seeing tonight. The outcome is uncertain, so that work sort of goes on in private. But Chris Christie and his staff had vetted cabinet members. There was a list, and I think we just didn't ask a lot of questions because we trusted what we were seeing in the polls and didn't think we'd be talking about a Trump cabinet. But all that work that goes on both sides has gone on the Trump side.
All right, the camera continuing to pan the crowd there, all eyes on the TV monitors and the stage. Folks waiting and hoping for a call. Certainly waiting to see their candidate, Donald Trump, who will have a lot to say when he comes out here because... And though he had predicted victory, that most of the polls had largely pointed against that happening. This will be a stunning upset if, it, in fact, this is how it all plays out. We continue to watch those states crawl at the bottom of your screen there. These are the ones we see as too close to call. Katie Turr is in that room. Katie, what are they seeing on the screen? What are they hearing?
They're watching Fox News, and they are waiting just like everybody else here. You can see there's a woman right there who's even yawning. Many of these people, again, have been here since 3 o'clock this afternoon. And if there's one parallel from what we've seen around the country is that Donald Trump supporters will wait hours on end for him to come out. We are seeing some movement up on the balconies, people shaking hands, congratulating each other. We're seeing members of Donald Trump's staff down by the buffer area where the stage is. Also, the pool crew has been pacing back and forth, unclear at this point whether he will come in from the left side or the right side, although we do believe it will probably be from the left side. I heard you guys talking a little bit about potential cabinet choices, and this is all extraordinarily preliminary at this point because Donald Trump didn't want to have these conversations behind the scenes with his staff because he was very superstitious about it. He didn't want to jinx his chances. Staff members told me that he would tell the story of 2012, having a conversation with Mitt Romney, and Mitt Romney saying that he was too busy to talk because he was dealing with the transition, and Donald Trump reacting by saying, "What do you mean transition? You haven't won the election yet." Who knows if he actually had that conversation with Mitt Romney, but that is the story that his campaign had relayed to me. So his campaign essentially was left to behind the scenes start to posture for positions that they might want. I had conversation where folks were telling me, "I don't know, what have you heard about me? What do you think I should do? I think I'd like to do this, that, or the other." But the names that I did hear from a number of sources, both inside the campaign and even one in the national security realm, NBC News heard, was that General Mike Flynn, retired General Mike Flynn, for potentially for National Security Advisor. We got that from a few different sources. Also, Newt Gingrich for Secretary of State, Rudy Giuliani for Attorney General, Reince Priebus for Chief of Staff. These are names that we are very familiar with at this point because they travel with Donald Trump and they've been so visible on the campaign trail. Who knows if they will be ultimately on this whittled down list. But what I can tell you is that Donald Trump does prize loyalty above all else. And these men have been very loyal to Donald Trump through the thick and thin of this campaign, through the roller coaster ride, standing by him. Even when other Republicans were admonishing him or refusing to endorsement, withholding their endorsement, revoking their endorsement, then coming back around. At some points, even Newt Gingrich, chastised Donald Trump for his responses or behavior. Reince Priebus would go quiet at points during the campaign. Rudy Giuliani at times struggling to defend Donald Trump. You just heard a huge cheer from the crowd. They're reacting to what they're seeing on Fox News. Essentially, though, what happens next with the Trump campaign is still very much an unknown, guys. And that's going to be the big question that dominates the news cycle for the next 3 months.
All right, we're watching a celebration at Trump headquarters. We'll keep in mind they are not reacting to anything that we have reported.
Another news organization, yeah, I guess.
Let's go to NBC's Kelly O'Donnell. Kelly?
Lester, I can tell you that sources tell me that Hillary Clinton has telephoned Donald Trump to concede this election. It is now President-elect Donald Trump. Sources say the phone call was placed just a short time ago where the former Secretary of State has conceded the general election to Donald Trump, who has never held elective office and is now the President-elect. Lester?
Kelly O'Donnell, and if that is the case, that occurred less than an hour after John Podesta came before the crowd and said all the votes need to be counted and invited the crowd to go home. But listen, everyone is looking at the same data, drawing conclusions perhaps at a different pace, but it's becoming clearer and clearer where this is all pointing. Right now we have Donald Trump at 248, 218 for Hillary Clinton. There's the breakdown for you of the electoral votes in the race to 270. Nonetheless, there is excitement here, as we said, others interpret the data differently. And we do expect to hear from Donald Trump in a few moments, who will have he'll have a lot to say, and rightfully so. He will have pulled off, if in fact he is victorious, he will have pulled off the equivalent of a 10 magnitude political earthquake in this country on every level. But you can see the smiles, the waves, the signs in the air at the Trump headquarters. All this, by the way, taking place just about four blocks from us, right down here on 6th Avenue at the Hilton Hotel.
This is a reminder, and maybe I'm channeling my inner Brokaw over here. People have spoken, and everybody needs to accept this. You know, you can be frustrated by it.
That's the way it works.
That's right. This is American democracy. It's at its best. People turned out. You would feel worse about a situation like this if this were a low turnout election and you felt it was somehow manipulated. This is a high turnout election. Okay, everybody had their say in this, and it's a wake up call to a lot of the establishments of both parties. It's a wake up call to we in the news media. I have to tell you, I've thought about this and how we covered the Great Recession, and how we covered the economic downturn. We covered it statistically, both as it was going down, and we covered it statistically as we were going up. We never touched these communities enough. I know I'm going to go through this, and I know plenty of other people are going to go through this, but we got to acknowledge this. I mean, this is the populace. We're in this economic transition. There's no doubt about it, going from this industrial economy where jobs, people knew what their job was going to be, to this service. Nobody knows. Uber, I'll tell you something Steve Schmidt said on my show the other day. He's like, you know, Uber's goal is to not have any employees. Uber doesn't want to have any drivers.
because they want to go driverless.
But what's so interesting is Trump's making big promises to this community of voters, saying, I'm going to bring those jobs back, and I'm going to reverse the clock, and I'm going to make your lives closer to what they were before, and that is a huge promise. And yep. Now it's up to him
Ladies
to deliver.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Vice President-elect of the United States, Governor Mike.
Vice President-elect in that introduction to Mike Pence, Governor Mike Pence. You're looking live here at the Trump headquarters in Midtown Manhattan. And there is Governor Mike Pence, as we said, introduced as the Vice President-elect.
Even in this close inner circle, didn't know how tonight was going to turn out. So I doubt that all these speeches were ready when the polls closed tonight.
I talked to a top Trump source today who made it pretty clear it wasn't one of those situations where we've got two drafts ready to go. They're sitting on the printer.
And the headline, Kelly O'Donnell reporting a source saying that Clinton has called Trump to concede the election.
And I've talked to somebody in the Clinton campaign. They've confirmed that. Piece of great reporting.
Here's Governor Pence, who didn't often seem on the same page with his running mate, but he is about to give the remarks.
This is a historic night. The American people have spoken, and the American people have elected their new champion. America has elected a new president, and it's almost hard for me to express the honor that I and my family feel that we will have the privilege to serve as your Vice President of the United States of America. I come to this moment deeply humbled, grateful to God for His amazing grace. Grateful to my family, my wonderful wife, Karen, our son, Michael, and his fiancée, Sarah, our daughter, Audrey, far away, and our daughter, Charlotte. I could not be here without them. And I'm deeply grateful to the American people for placing their confidence in this team and giving us this opportunity to serve. And I'm mostly grateful to our president-elect, whose leadership and vision will make America great again. So let me say, it is my high honor and distinct privilege to introduce to you the President-elect of the United States of America, Donald Trump.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody. Sorry to keep you waiting. Complicated business. Complicated. Thank you very much. I've just received a call from Secretary Clinton. She congratulated us, it's about us, on our victory. And I congratulated her and her family on a very, very hard-fought campaign. I mean, she fought very hard. Hillary has worked very long and very hard over a long period of time, and we owe her a major debt of gratitude for her service to our country. I mean that very sincerely. Now it's time for America to bind the wounds of division. We have to get together. To all Republicans and Democrats and independents across this nation, I say it is time for us to come together as one united people. It's time. I pledge to every citizen of our land that I will be president for all Americans, and this is so important to me. For those who have chosen not to support me in the past, of which there were a few people, I'm reaching out to you for your guidance and your help so that we can work together and unify our great country. As I've said from the beginning, ours was not a campaign, but rather an incredible and great movement made up of millions of hardworking men and women who love their country and want a better, brighter future for themselves and for their family. It's a movement comprised of Americans from all races, religions, backgrounds, and beliefs who want and expect our government to serve the people, and serve the people it will. Working together, we will begin the urgent task of rebuilding our nation and renewing the American dream. I've spent my entire life in business looking at the untapped potential in projects and in people all over the world. That is now what I want to do for our country. Tremendous potential. I've gotten to know our country so well. Tremendous potential. It's going to be a beautiful thing. Every single American will have the opportunity to realize his or her fullest potential. The forgotten men and women of our country will be forgotten no longer. We are going to fix our inner cities and rebuild our highways, bridges, tunnels, airports, schools, hospitals. We're going to rebuild our infrastructure, which will become, by the way, second to none. And we will put millions of our people to work as we rebuild it. We will also finally take care of our great veterans. We've been so loyal, and I've gotten to know so many over this 18-month journey. The time I've spent with them during this campaign has been among my greatest honors. Our veterans are incredible people. We will embark upon a project of national growth and renewal. I will harness the creative talents of our people, and we will call upon the best and brightest to leverage their tremendous talent for the benefit of all. It's going to happen. We have a great economic plan. We will double our growth and have the strongest economy anywhere in the world. At the same time, we will get along with all other nations willing to get along with us. We will be. We'll have great relationships. We expect to have great, great relationships. No dream is too big. No challenge is too great. Nothing we want for our future is beyond our reach. America will no longer settle for anything less than the best. We must reclaim our country's destiny and dream big and bold and daring. We have to do that. We're going to dream of things for our country and beautiful things and successful things once again. I want to tell the world community that while we will always put America's interests first, we will deal fairly with everyone, all people and all other nations. We will seek common ground, not hostility, partnership, not conflict. And now, I'd like to take this moment to thank some of the people who really helped me with this, what they are calling tonight, very, very historic victory. First, I want to thank my parents, who I know are looking down on me right now. Great people. I've learned so much from them. They were wonderful in every regard. I had truly great parents. I also want to thank my sisters, Marianne and Elizabeth, who are here with us tonight. And where are they? They're here someplace. They're very shy, actually. And my brother, Robert, my great friend. Where is Robert? Where is Robert? My brother, Robert. And they should all be on this stage, but that's okay. They are great. And also my late brother, Fred, great guy, fantastic guy. Fantastic family. I was very lucky. Great brothers, sisters, great, unbelievable parents. To Melania and Don. And Ivanka. And Eric. And Tiffany. And Baron. I love you and I thank you. And especially for putting up with all of those hours. This was tough. This was tough. This political stuff is nasty and it's tough. So I want to thank my family very much. Really fantastic. Thank you all. Thank you all. And Lara, unbelievable job. Unbelievable. Vanessa, thank you. Thank you very much. What a great group. You've all given me such incredible support, and I will tell you that we have a large group of people. You know, they kept saying we have a small staff. Not so small. Look at all the people that we have. Look at all of these people. And Kellyanne, and Chris, and Rudy, and Steve, and David. We have got tremendously talented people up here, and I want to tell you, it's been very, very special. I want to give a very special thanks to our former mayor, Rudy Giuliani. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. He traveled with us, and he went through meetings. And see that, Rudy? Never changes. Where's Rudy? Where is he? Rudy. Governor Chris Christie, folks, was unbelievable. Thank you, Chris. The first man, first senator, first major, major politician. And let me tell you, he is highly respected in Washington because he's as smart as you get. Senator Jeff Sessions. Where's Jeff? Great man. Another great man, very tough competitor. He was not easy. He was not easy. Who was that? Is that the mayor that showed up? that Rudy? Oh, Rudy got up here. Another great man who has been really a friend to me. But I'll tell you, I got to know him as a competitor because he was one of the folks that was negotiating to go against those Democrats. Dr. Ben Carson. Where's Ben? Where is Ben? And by the way, Mike Huckabee is here someplace, and he is fantastic. Mike and his family, Sarah, thank you very much. General Mike Flynn. Where is Mike? And General Kellogg. We have over 200 generals and admirals that have endorsed our campaign, and they're special people, and it's really an honor. We have 22 Congressional Medal of Honor recipients. We have just tremendous people. A very special person who, believe me, and, you know, I'd read reports that I wasn't getting along with him. I never had a bad second with him. He's an unbelievable star. He is — that's right. How did you possibly guess? So let me tell you about Reince. And I've said this. I said Reince, and I know it. I know it. Look at all those people over there. I know it. Reince is a superstar. But I said, they can't call you a superstar, Reince, unless we win. Because you can't be called a superstar like Secretariat. If Secretariat came in second, Secretariat would not have that big, beautiful bronze bust at the track at Belmont. But I'll tell you, Reince is really a star. And he is the hardest working guy. And in a certain way, I did this. Reince, come up here. Where is Reince? Get over here, Reince. Boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. It's about time you did this, Reince. Huh? My God. Yeah, say a few words. No, come on. Say something.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next president of the United States, Donald Trump. Thank you. It's been an honor. God bless. Thank God.
Amazing guy. Our partnership with the RNC was so important to the success and what we've done. So I also have to say I've gotten to know some incredible people, the Secret Service people. They're tough, and they're smart, and they're sharp, and I don't want to mess around with them, I can tell you. And when I want to go and wave to a big group of people and they rip me down and put me back down in the seat. But they are fantastic people, so I want to thank the Secret Service. And law enforcement in New York City, they're here tonight. These are spectacular people, sometimes underappreciated, unfortunately. But we appreciate them. We know what they go through. So it's been what they call a historic event. But to be really historic, we have to do a great job. And I promise you that I will not let you down. We will do a great job. We will do a great job. I look very much forward to being your president. And hopefully at the end of 2 years or 3 years or 4 years or maybe even 8 years, you will say — so many of you work so hard for us — but
as Donald
you will
Trump
say that
continues to speak to the excited crowd here in New York, we can tell you our decision desk has now put Wisconsin and Pennsylvania
and
in the Trump column. He's the apparent winner.
And I can only say
that would make Trump the president elect. And of course, as he noted, Secretary Clinton had already called and
really
conceded. Let's listen now to Donald Trump.
We're going to get to work immediately for the American people. And we're going to be doing a job that hopefully you will be so proud of your president. You'll be so proud. Again, it's my honor. It was an amazing evening. It's been an amazing two-year period. And I love this country. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to Mike Pence. Thank you, everybody.
Donald Trump thanking his running mate Mike Pence. What a dramatic evening this has been. A nail biter, and then suddenly everything turned Donald Trump's way. A political earthquake, a come from behind story for the ages, a man who defied political gravity to walk on that stage tonight as the president-elect of the United States. Savannah Guthrie, you have been with me all evening. I don't think any of us at this table imagined the evening would end in quite the way it has.
No, and this is the rise to the occasion moment for Donald Trump, and the campaign was hard fought, and the really hard work begins now, because it's the hard work of uniting the country, it's the hard work of facing some very complex problems, and I think he struck the right tone in his remarks there, and said Secretary Clinton had called and graciously conceded. And now I think, you know, all Americans are exhausted by this campaign and hoping that somehow, some way, we can find a way to move forward and unite. And
we're gonna wake
that's
up in
the order of business now.
We're going to wake up in the morning to a Brexit-like reaction in the stock market. That's going to rattle a lot of Americans. So President-elect Trump, you know, that was, I agree. I think he rose to the occasion tonight and did what you do for your supporters. Secretary Clinton did the right thing and what she needed to do. But he's now quickly got to address sort of this panicked reaction that there is out there in the financial markets. And so that's what a president has to do. He's now president-elect. He needs to stabilize this economy quickly before that whole thing rattles.
I had more than one person text me tonight and say, well, there goes my retirement again, you know, when you see Dow futures down multiple hundreds of points. So we'll see if that settles down. As we talked about earlier, Wall Street hadn't exactly priced this into the market. We'll see what the long-term effect is. But
we're going to continue this discussion here, but I think we want to excuse you now. You've got to be on the Today Show. You guys are going up at 6?
Six or seven, I don't even know.
Six or seven, but you have been a trooper.
Why don't you just start now?
Yeah, we're just starting. Tell Matt to sleep and I'm here. I'm awake.
Exactly.
I'm all dressed up.
I think you're all going to be here tomorrow, so thank you.
But I know, so we're going to let you get out of here, Savannah, and we'll bring over Hallie Jackson here.
Thanks, partner.
Thank you.
I want to get Andrea's reaction. Your story on Nightly News, which feels like it was years ago, you know, this was an upbeat Clinton campaign. They felt good. Pennsylvania was part of this firewall. We watched it all collapse over the last several hours.
And it crumbled very quickly, really, when we saw the tightening very early on in several key areas. But that was early data, very little raw vote. But those early indicators were alarm bells, certainly. And then when I was told by a very reliable Democrat in Michigan, this is really making us nervous. We're not seeing that vote turnout in Detroit and Flint. That was pretty early, and everyone was saying, well, this couldn't be happening. Look, Chuck just alluded to the markets. It's global markets that have been collapsing overnight. And the fact is that Donald Trump has to rectify that. He could be facing the kind of economic collapse that Barack Obama inherited when he took office. He's got to face this and come up with a plan that is completely different from his economic plan, the $5 trillion debt hole that all independent observers have said is his economic plan. He has got to reassure markets very quickly.
File out now after Donald Trump left the stage, but there are still quite a large number of people here, and many people obviously wanting to get a picture with now President-elect Donald Trump. He took the stage with a number of his top aides, but also his family by his side, his wife Melania, his son Barron, daughter Ivanka, her husband Jared Kushner, his sons Eric and Don, and their wives as well. It was a very jubilant moment for them. You could almost, maybe it's just me, but you could almost see the surprise, the shock, or the moment hitting them on their faces. And if you asked me to predict if Donald Trump would come out and give a speech as gracious as that just was, especially towards Hillary Clinton, I would point towards what he did in Iowa after he lost to Ted Cruz. He did surprise everybody by coming out and giving quite a gracious speech. The question is, what Donald Trump do we see tomorrow and going forward? And where do the very many policies that he's put forth during this campaign season What happens to them? And does he follow through with the promises of building a wall? Remember, it was only a few days ago that Donald Trump was promising to put Hillary Clinton in jail. He was promising to investigate the investigation into the FBI. He was calling the system rigged. He was saying, obviously, they were out to get him. Obviously, the system was rigged in Hillary Clinton's favor. That is no longer the case for Donald Trump as he has won this election. I wonder how he continues to react towards Hillary Clinton and how he reacts to whether or not Hillary Clinton does take some sort of stage tomorrow to address the American public. It is quite a reversal. For the past few months, everybody had been wondering if Donald Trump were to lose this election, how would he concede? A lot of scrutiny around him about whether he would concede graciously as the polls showed him behind. And now what we are seeing is that Donald Trump came out and graciously accepted the president-elect title, and Hillary Clinton still has not addressed the American public.
Right.
He says that she did call him and that she congratulated us. He made a point to say us.
And Katie, it was interesting watching him. You're right, there was so much humility there. He talked about being president for all Americans, reaching out to those who did not support him. Hallie Jackson is with us right now. That was a very presidential speech. And those of us who watched him, certainly you watched him during the primary, you watched him during the general election, we're all left to wonder now, is that President Trump we saw?
He has had presidential moments through this campaign. He has some moments that his critics would argue were very not presidential. I think what you saw from Donald Trump over the last 45 minutes or so was him trying to basically set the tone. Remember what had happened in the last couple of weeks of this campaign. Privately, his campaign was, I would almost say, defiantly confident in their projections and their mapping. They'd been talking about Michigan before I think a lot of folks have been talking about and seeing Michigan. They had identified some of these places that were going to be key battlegrounds, talking about Pennsylvania, talking about Wisconsin, some of these key states. But look back, not just in the last couple of weeks, but to what we saw this entire primary season, from the day that he announced, from the day that Ted Cruz first became the candidate to get into the race 600 days ago, Donald Trump defeated all of his primary challengers. He has been the unexpected candidate from the very beginning. There are Republican sources on Capitol Hill tonight who are saying things like, well, now he's going to have to learn how to fall in line with Congress.
Oh, yeah?
Does he? Says who? Donald Trump would have something to say about that.
I never thought somebody who may or may not win the popular vote, may not cross 300 electoral votes, I never thought I would say that person has a mandate. But this person has a mandate.
You went through that map lately?
Donald
That's a lot of red.
Trump has a mandate because of how he won and because it was in defiance of the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, the professional intelligentsia in this country, whether it's we in the news media, the academics, you name it. So he owes nothing to those folks. Now, you want to get something done? Okay, that's another story. But he doesn't owe anybody anything. It is a fascinating, I'm trying to think of the last president, Andrea, that didn't owe, you know, they didn't owe sort of political party, didn't owe a lot of fundraisers. He comes in without owing a lot of people much.
Andrew Jackson?
Yeah, exactly. You got to go back to Andrew Jackson. No,
I think this is
a modern day Andrew Jackson.
James Carville, when do you suspect we would hear from Hillary Clinton? And how does she craft a message, given the way she positioned Donald Trump as an enemy of democracy?
Right. I think that Hillary Clinton, she never conveyed it to me, but I don't have any doubt that she thinks that Donald Trump is a threat to the country. I think she thinks that he's totally unprepared to be president, that he really doesn't know anything about what it takes to run the country. And she's going to have to go out there tomorrow, and it's going to be very, very tough for her. I mean, we live in a democracy. The election is in. He won the election. You're right, he doesn't owe anybody anything, you know, no Republican Party anything. He's not even a Republican. He pretty much won on his own terms. And, you know, probably people elected him because he did that, because he did win on his own terms. But it is going to be an unbelievably difficult time for Secretary Clinton.
Is it going to be an acceptance, though? Those who were vehemently against him, an acceptance period, and they will allow him a honeymoon. And like, okay, let's see.
You know, you can't unring a bell. I mean, you know, if you're a person and he, you know, accused of President Obama not being born here, I mean, it'd be a lot of things. You go back and you say it's all. I mean, things happen in this campaign. He said things in this campaign that have never been said before about anybody in a campaign. I don't know. I don't know. And there are a lot of, you know, going to be very. Yeah, people say, well, I hope he succeeds. It's good for the country. They'll have to rally around him. To some extent, he has the authority of an election. We live in a democracy. He won the election. It has consequences.
But by the way, look, we've had Jesse Ventura as a governor of Minnesota out of nowhere. We've had Arnold Schwarzenegger. James, I'm just curious that when you look at that, you know, and people, there were some predictions of these people don't know what the heck they're doing. California didn't fall into the ocean. Minnesota didn't get taken over by Canada. He struggled to govern. Ventura did. And Ventura, by the way, comes in very similar to Trump. Ventura struggled. He didn't get along with either party, couldn't get along with his legislature. It was tough to get things done. And that's something Trump, he ought to look at that and say, hey, be careful when you come in with owing nobody anything. You still need to figure out how to work with your legislature. But, you know, we've gone through.
No state falls off the face of the earth.
Right.
All right. I mean, it's a little bit different when we talk about a country. But the last time we had a president, you know, people would say, gee, we're having a disastrous war. We had a catastrophic recession. I mean, there was some real consequences here. And I mean, yeah, Minnesota could survive a lot. I mean, not the United States is not going to cease to exist, but there are all kinds of issues. If you take what he said, you know, he wants to renegotiate the debt. We're going to withdraw from every climate agreement we're in. Just going to be the end of the system of health insurance we have. I mean, all of these things are things that he said, and you have to take him serious. The people have validated that.
But when you talk to his supporters on the campaign trail, when you speak with folks at his rallies about some of these policies and his messaging, what they say is, well, we know that he'll really listen to the smart people around him once he is president-elect, once he ends up in the Oval Office. They don't necessarily believe that he will follow through on every single one of his policies. But they believe he'll listen to his advice.
Well, what evidence do we have? What evidence do we have, honestly, that Donald Trump has ever listened to anybody? But what evidence? I mean, he hasn't even prepared. I mean, I'm being just honest here. People may say that. There is no evidence that he listened. He is a man that said, I know more about ISIS than the generals. Let's don't delude ourselves here. We know what just got elected in this country.
But I would just question what we know about his judgment in choosing people and staff. That's all. If in choosing cabinet, choosing staff,
he listened to somebody in Mike Pence, because that wasn't his first choice. He got talked into Mike Pence as a more go pick yourself a traditional Republican. Yeah.
And that was a very odd relationship, because he ended up. Sometimes they would give different answers to the same question.
And let's not forget, it was, did he wait 24 hours, Hallie, before saying he was reaffirming that he was staying on the ticket after the Access Hollywood tape? So, you know, Pence had some internal struggles with Trump's morality and some of those things. But I go back to that because, James, to answer your question, he did listen to somebody on Pence, because Pence wasn't his idea. I guess the question is, is that how he picks his cabinet? That he is going to listen to more traditional?
You know, one thing I know about smart people is they never agree on anything. If you get five smart people in a room, you're going to get seven opinions. The idea that smart people somehow or another, you know, have a consensus or something like that. And look, I hope I'm wrong. And I don't want to be like sour grapes. I mean, I'm obviously devastated. I hope I'm wrong. But everything that I've seen about his conduct, about things that he said, leads me to believe that.
Hey, James, who's the leader of the Democratic Party right now?
No one. The Democratic Party is devastating. It won't have the federal courts, it won't have the Congress, it won't have the presidency, it won't have 30 or 31 state legislators. You know, we're a party in search of a leader. It's a very, very tough time to be a Democrat.
We talk about the Senate remaining Republican. This was supposed to be the cycle for Democrats. 2 years from now, the Democrats have more exposure and more seats at stake.
Correct. So don't forget, midterms, by the way, midterms get turned upside down.
That's true.
It's the part, all of a sudden now the midterms are going to...
it's a tougher challenge. It's a big
no doubt, but midterms do get flipped over. Party in power now is the odds.
It's almost certain that she's going to win a popular vote.
Right, because California...
I just... David Wasserman, who knows this better than any 10 people, just said, it's almost certain, which is... And he comes within the age of Texas and wins a popular vote.
That's what makes it...
You know, this will be going back and forth. I think the election would have been the same without that. But how can I prove it? I can't. It's just, it's a game. What do you say?
A lot of Democrats are never going to believe. That's never going to go away.
I understand.
Hallie's the expert on this, but it just seems to me that in those 9 days, the rhetoric, the locker up, it had been there and then it kind of died down a bit.
Remember, the Obamacare thing blew up with the premiums going up in that same window.
And that is the messaging that Donald Trump got on even before the original Comey announcement came out that Friday. His campaign privately talked about seeing the polls tighten even before that because he was on that healthcare message. And I would say this, in those 9 days, here's what I think was one of the more significant developments. Donald Trump seeing what was happening when he was staying on message and listening, to your point, to some of the people around him who said stay on script, talk about the Affordable Care Act, go after Hillary Clinton. He saw the polls begin to tighten, and it was kind of a self-fulfilling cycle in that respect.
But
the big story.
Is he a Breitbart or a Steve Bannon or a Kellyanne Conway president?
The diversity of voices that he's listening to. Coming out of this campaign, and what happened is going to be there were people in the Clinton campaign who said we need to have an economic message, we need to close on this. And there were people that said if we close on temperament and we have this unbelievable get out the vote effort is what it's going to take to win. Obviously, the second camp ended out, had the day. That is going to be something that is going to be gone over in a thousand times as this is done.
I need to get out to Kelly O'Donnell in Wisconsin, who's got some reporting for us. Kelly?
Well, one of the things we need to think about, Lester, is that now that he is president-elect, within days, Donald Trump and Mike Pence will get higher-level intelligence briefings to prepare them in transition to take office. As candidates, they had received some basic level. This will now be amped up. And one of the things that one can expect when you move from that point of being candidate to president-elect is the sober nature of everything that becomes a responsibility on his shoulders. So he will be informed at a greater level now to prepare. And that, of course, will be involved in the decisions that he has to make to set up a new administration. In conversations I've had with Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, he has talked about a willingness to try to work with Trump and to have a lot of policy ideas prepared for him and hope that they can work together to get some of these things done. Now, with Republicans in control of the White House, the House of Representatives, and the United States Senate. Lester?
All right, Kelly, this headline has been written as we're on the air. We can show you some of the headlines here as we continue our conversation. The folks who are not with us who will be waking up to Trump stuns the world. Andrea, let me ask you about President Obama and Michelle Obama. They put blood, sweat, and tears in this campaign. This was an argument not only for Hillary Clinton's candidacy, but for his legacy.
I have been thinking about that very thing, Lester. We had been led to believe that whoever was elected, President Obama would greet them, welcome them to the White House on Thursday of this week. That wasn't announced, but that was what sources were saying was going to happen. And I was just thinking a couple of days ago, what if it's President Trump? And Barack Obama is welcoming the man he says and his wife believes profoundly was trying to delegitimize him, was questioning his whether he was the legitimate president, his birth, his ancestry. They believe he is racist. They have,
Michelle Obama had given that amazing speech about
at the convention. They had to raise their children in this atmosphere. There is a passion about the legacy, and it's personal. It's deeply personal. For him and for Michelle Obama to do everything that they did for Hillary Clinton was motivated not just by policy, but by the emotion of countering Donald Trump and of defeating Donald Trump. And now we're going to see the majesty of our democracy. And what is it going to take for Barack Obama to welcome the Trumps? for Mrs. Obama to show Melania Trump around the White House, for that image that we've all seen on the North Portico on Inauguration Day when they come for coffee and then the two men, because now it will be a male president, get in the back seat of that limo and ride up to Capitol Hill for an inaugural ceremony. I mean, it's just stunning when you think of the drama of it. It's a narrative you could not begin
to
imagine.
Because of the relationship the two have.
Exactly.
Or whatever you want to call it.
Not a relationship.
Yes,
it's
so much. It's so toxic. You know, there is, for many African Americans in this country, what he did with birtherism is an unforgivable sin. And I think, my guess is for many members of the Obama family, what he did was an unforgivable sin.
And remind you, he never answered the question of what changed his mind, what ultimately brought him to...
He never apologized to the President of the United States. And I always thought, and I have to say, now that he's about to become, it's late, but that's another thing. We talked about economics. The fact of the matter is, we are a country that is going to feel more divided by race than we have had probably since before I was born in the 60s. And Donald Trump's got to preside over that, too. It's in his best interest to perhaps repair a personal relationship with the outgoing president if he even has a chance.
Plus foreign policy, Vladimir Putin.
I think a lot of people feel like that America told them exactly of African-Americans, Latinos, Muslims, you name it, Asians. I think a lot of people tonight are feeling like, you know, the United States told me exactly what they think of me. And I think a lot of people are really feeling down.
African-American woman say that to me earlier.
Right. Hey. And you know, people like myself who like really believe in a pluralistic nation, you know, but they really think it's really part of our character. I mean, I'm like, gee, we just really do this. And, you know, I'll be fine, I'll come to grips with it, but it is hard, it is impossible to overestimate the magnitude of this is a political story. It just cannot be overestimated.
And I can't underscore enough, Andrew, your point too, that this is not just about policy, this is deeply personal for a lot of Americans, for probably half of Americans out there, members of the African-American community, members of the Hispanic community, who are looking at their neighbors wondering what happens now.
All right, Hallie and James Carville and Chuck Todd and Andrea Mitchell, great to have all of you here as part of our coverage. It's going to do it for NBC News coverage on this decision night in America, a night that will go down in history. A stunning upset as Donald Trump triumphs over Hillary Clinton, defying the polls, the pundits, and the political class, once again, this time elected president of the United States. Coverage continues on many of these NBC stations, on MSNBC on cable, and at NBCNews.com. And all the reaction coming in just a few hours from now with Matt and Savannah on Today. For Chuck Todd, Tom Brokaw, and our entire election night team, I'm Lester Holt. Good night, everyone, from New York.